And let's see what we've got. There's the TF band to begin things against Najin and the Jarvan band. Okay.
Well, actually, Ketch has played a lot of Jungle Jarvan this season, but that's mostly against Sossin, cheesing him like he did against Jhin Air. Vayne, of course, a very common band, leveled at OQ, who can go absolutely crazy on that pick.
You know, you got to avoid the Jarvan flex pick for Spenu. You know, that not many teams supply that threat, but Spenu's got it, apparently. There's the Kalista ban on red side, not too surprising.
I actually really like the Jarvan ban here, even though they're banning it with a ban on the red side. Because remember, not only is that you don't want Goom to play against it, it's annoying to deal with, but if Ketch picks it, it's going to prevent Najin from taking Ghost Olaf.
Oh, that's a good point.
So there's actually a lot of value to banning Jarvan here if you're Najin.
There's the Elise ban, not going to let Watch have any chance of getting that one. And the Ryze ban, again, something that we've come to expect from Najin picks and bans, like you said, no matter what side they're on. So what's the first pick going to be? Rek'Sai is still available. They may want to take that away. Hecarim would be an interesting first choice.
No.
I don't know if I'd go with that. With Maokai still up, with a lot of options.
No.
Spenu,
no.
Don't do this. I just said I was a fan of you. There we go. There's the Victor. That makes a lot more sense.
Yeah, they beat Jhin Air with Victor in that third game, so it does mean that Spenu should have some confidence in Sossin's abilities on that champion, and just a great takeaway from Goom. That said, Goom's Azir is looking pretty good these days, and I think that should be a pretty logical pick. You'll win lane against the Victor here. You don't have to worry too much about it. And that's it, pretty much. I'd take Maokai, I'd take Rek'Sai here, and or I'd take Annie or Braum, that's another option.
Should work if they lock that in.
Now notice that Braum's priority has gone down ever since Runeblade Ezreal was nerfed. That was one of the main reasons. Braum's still strong, he's still really good.
Of course.
But if we compare him to Annie or Alistar, it's just that instant engage is very nice to have.
Right. You don't need the shield, you don't need Braum. So Gragas would be a pretty expected pickup for Ketch. Again, Ketch has really had a tough season, both mechanics-wise, where he is on the map at any given time, his team fighting is lackluster. It has not been a good season debut for Ketch.
No, it hasn't. At least he got a win. He did look decent, to be fair to him, in the win against Spenu. He had a good series by his standards. Gragas is going to be a necessary pick here, or Lee Sin, and they have to be able to have early aggression. And it will be potentially a quirky takeaway.
Okay.
Remember that Najin's a big-time Lucian team, though, and Lucian Annie is scary.
Yep, and immediately the Lucian hovered over. I wouldn't be surprised if it was locked in either. What's the other pick going to be here? They could look at a top laner. And you'd think with the Maokai still available, that would be pretty tempting right now.
I think they're just going to counterpick the top laner. I really think they want to take Olaf.
It makes sense. I suppose they can pick mid now where they already know it's going to be the Victor. They already have the good matchup in Goom's Azir, and they should lock it in. But yeah, the Olaf could be coming. Tom Kench, that would be awesome, but I really doubt it.
Yeah.
Kench is not spectacularly good right now. Maybe 5-15, but even then, 5-14 is still not that great for Tom Kench.
Yes, the old Tom Kench Draven lane. I don't think so.
Dude, if they lock this in, how swag would that be?
Well, you're not going to blind pick a Yasuo in the top lane, so.
Well, yeah, you support Yasuo, obviously.
Oh, of course, naturally. Yeah.
It's going to be a top lane Tom Kench. The only place he can go, according to a lot of people these days. Aww.
Yeah, I think you take that for a secret. It's been one of his better champions. Just go ahead, grab the Alistar so you get reliable engage from secret. Shen, a safe blind pick in the top lane.
No. Okay. Don't quit playing games with my heart. That's what people said when you used to mess with the support player on Samsung Blue back in the day, too.
Don't play games with my heart. Well, now
quit playing games.
Quit playing games with my heart. Yeah. He's now in China on unlimited potential.
Yeah. Unfortunately.
Unfortunately.
The potential seems to be quite limited right now. Yeah, okay. So Alistar. And like you mentioned, Secret has had a lot of good games on Alistar. Whenever you see this guy play, you're like, wow, he really does know how to engage well with this champion. And this is why I'm a fan of Spenu, because I feel like even though they've had a pretty disastrous season, there really is something there.
There's some pieces, yeah. I think Sossen is definitely a promising talent.
Yeah. I mean, mid AD carry and support, I think, is a pretty solid foundation to build on for this team. Top and jungle, you probably want to look at some roster changes, but overall, it's not bad. And that's going to be the Gnar for the final pickup for Najin. Duke's going to grab that, so no Olaf, I guess.
Yeah, the Gnar, though, we saw how well he can do in the split push versus Shen in the previous series. Did definitely exert a lot of pressure with an early Black Cleaver. Yeah. Given the way that Duke plays, probably can expect something similar to that build coming out of Najin again.
I wanted to see the Olaf. I'm a little bit disappointed, but I guess the Gnar will be okay as well. Reach saying, please, guys, don't get 2-0'd by Spenu. I don't think he's got much to worry about, though.
Nope. Comfort picks across the board for Najin.
Yep.
Fantastic team composition for them. They've got great protection for their back line. They have good engage. An Annie ult straight into a Gnar ult and a Rek'Sai knockup. Beautifully orchestrated team composition. Spenu has a nice one, too, though. They can engage with the Alistar and the Gragas. They have good protection with that Shen. So, very well-rounded team composition in this game. It contrasts to our lack of engage in the last series.
Yeah, this is going to come down a lot to team ability, individual ability, too. No big compositional mismatches, which should be good for game number one. And we'll see if Spenu can continue to improve on a little bit of success lately, or if Najin is just going to stomp him flat. Going to the postseason, let's see who takes game number one. It's time to get in the game. Welcome once again to Summoner's Rift. Spenu Sonic Boom versus Najin EM Fire. And Spenu, of course, coming off of that 2-1 victory, their first of the season over the Jhinnir Green Wings. And now, Jhinnir's season relying on Spenu to 2-0 Najin.
Yeah, but Najin's really going to want this. And for those of you who don't know, the reason why is they only have to win one best of three to guarantee themselves a playoff seed. But their last match of the season is versus SK Telecom. So take the easy win here while you can. There's a Goong assigned jersey, Najin fighting.
Interesting. I believe they came from Busan, if I read that all correctly. And I might not have, believe it or not. I tried to channel my inner Chobra.
Channel the Chobra?
That's right.
Well, you end up in Germany if that happens, so be careful. I'd like to keep you here for the rest of the cast.
That's true. And I don't understand German, so if I started speaking it, I would just really confuse myself. Like, what are you saying? Me?
Just wander around saying Wunderbar all the time. I find that very effective.
It's a good way to approach League of Legends play-by-play casting. There you go.
Wunderbar!
Gnar. Wow. Okay. That's going to be haunting my nightmares for a couple weeks at least. Gromp, save me! Okay, thank you. Gromp sacrificing his life to prevent us from more nightmare fuel coming from Korean gentleman Gnar.
Well, now, Najin definitely did want standard lanes here. They're not going to be too upset about not getting them. Even though that would have been preferable, they still have a roaming Annie on the map.
Yeah.
Which is a nice thing to have. Pure is going to be late, however, after the leash. Not going to find anything there because the buff was started on the weak side by Spenu. That's definitely how you want to do it.
Fan of nuclear there in the audience. And those players, Sossen, Nuclear, and Secret, they excite me, I think.
Do they excite you, Noah?
I have a feeling we will see them for quite a while here.
Do they make you shiver with anticipation?
No. But they excite me a little bit. Yeah, see, here's the thing, is that I feel like in every sport, you need the team you're truly a fan of, and then you need like a bad team you're a fan of, you know? So that, because it's always fun to cheer for the underdog, right? But it's also always fun to cheer for the team that wins a lot. So why not have both?
Who's your B team in the NFL?
The Browns.
Oh, jeez.
The Cleveland Browns, because they really don't win, but man, it's adorable. And so that's why Spenu is essentially the Cleveland Browns of a Korean League of Legends. So that's why Spenu is my other favorite team.
Okay, Doha. It's not that bad. Spenu at least is a new team. The Browns are just sitting there never winning Super Bowls for
OQ.
Forever, basically. OQ.
Yeah.
Getting jumped on out of the brush by
so are the Vikings.
Secret. Vikings make.
They make the Super Bowl once in a while. They just don't win it.
So I think that your representation is ill, but hello, nuclear.
Oh, boy, nuclear. Nuke from orbit tries to get away with the Valkyrie, but that ignite is ticking away, and first blood going over to Duke. But look at this. In the mid lane, a play onto this Rek'Sai. That's going to be two kills coming in for Spenu. Okay, then. Sauce and nuclear each picking up one themselves as well.
Yeah, Nuclear didn't use his flash, but used his summoner heal to stay long enough and watch only level 3. And Goon gets caught as soon as they see that play moving into the top side. They're able to interrupt Goon. That was just a really good flash from Secret 2 because he blocked Goon from getting to his Sand Soldier.
Yeah, and that's the type of play that we keep talking about, Secret making. And he really has made a big difference in terms of team fighting, in terms of picks. And this Alistar, I would say, is pretty much his best champion.
Now, hilariously, even though the extra kill went to Spenu, the gold lead is actually in Najin's favor, because look at the difference now between OQ and Nuclear. OQ just able to farm up.
Wow.
So that is that's worth a kill right there.
I guess so, yeah.
Man, this is a bad situation. You've got the Lucian incredibly far ahead, and Gnar really wasn't slowed down by that. And in fact, Goon, because he's playing into this Victor matchup, had that better CS. He was zoning Victor off the wave before that happened. So it's not so bad, actually, for Najin.
I guess so.
When the dust settles, Nuclear had an early shop, of course, after he died, so not quite a complete phage yet.
Yeah, it is nice to get the kills on the Victor early on. Nice poke from Pure and OQ.
The fortunate thing for Nuclear is that he got the kill, so he's actually even in gold with OQ, which is nice. So that CS lead merely making up for the fact that there is a kill onto Nuclear.
It's good to see Spenu being aggressive early against Najin as well, too, because that's the strength that Najin has, is a lot of early game play. So if Nuclear and the rest of Spenu just tries to match it, I think that's kind of the best way to approach this.
Yeah, I think that you get down and dirty with Najin in the laning phase. You try and clip their wings.
I mean, this is a type of series where you would think it's going to be largely decided within the first 15, 20 minutes. You know, if both teams are just going to kind of go at it. And like, all right, whoever comes out of this with the big lead just gets to win.
Yeah, nice deep ward there from Ketch. Get some vision down on that side. Good pink. We'll see how long that sticks around, starting at about 6 minutes here. And in the meantime,
whoa, lots of damage on the soul here.
Yep, able to go aggressive because they saw Ketch in the top side with Watch's Tremor Sense, so they know where he is. And that means against two melee champions, you can safely trade aggressively, especially since Secret does not have a flash to shove you back into the tower.
It also means Goon can ward as well, too, and he gets a nice little bit of a deeper ward in the jungle, which is going to keep Pure and OQ even more safe.
Yep. So playing around OQ, the old staple here, you can see dead even in gold between the AD carries as a result of the CS differential and that kill.
Yep. And they're going to be able to do a decent amount of damage to this turret early on, too.
Yep, and some nice damage onto Sol right there. They're not really going to overplay their hand, just a little bit of harassment. Trying to push Sol out of lane. He has run out of potions now, but has that Doran shield for some more sustain. Goon will get the first blue buff of the game here for him.
All right. And no doubt he'll be putting it to good work. Surprisingly enough, a tiny little CS lead actually for Sassen here. I suppose it's from that fight. Normally you see the Azir a little bit ahead at this point.
Yeah, just from the kill. But Goon had built up enough of a buffer that he will not fall too far behind in spite of dying so early into this game.
Very true. And every Najin game kind of seems like you're waiting for the moment where OQ is just going to go off and start killing people.
Yeah. Maybe this will be a third game in a row that OQ doesn't die. I really love watching his Lucian play. Yeah. And I like the way that he and Pure play the laning phase. They'll play Kennen. They'll play Annie. They just the Thresh. They want champions that have kill pressure and that they can really dominate with. And it works so nicely for them.
Yes, it does. The killing didn't do a whole lot. But it will keep the lane pushed up at the very least.
So looks like it will be a phase for Duke to start off this laning phase against Shen. As expected, they want that Black Cleaver to maximize the damage in this matchup. Already has a phage, not yet completing the Sunfire Cape for Soul. And this worked out really well in our last series when it came to the split push pressure. Obviously, again, Gnar not going to be terribly useful for team fights, but if you get a tower and continue to push Shen out, and then on the opposite side of the map, they can have the Lucian dominating.
GBM fervently praying that Spenny was able to take this.
GBM is such a funny guy.
It's like an episode of it's like Dragon Ball, right? Where you're beaten by someone, but then you end up becoming friends anyway. No one has ever cheered for Spenny so hard.
Ooh. By the way, guys.
Oh, GBM.
If you haven't seen the True LOL show with GBM, it is subtitled in English, and it is really, really funny.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
Definitely check it out. He's an amazing character.
And there we go. A plan to Pure. Knocks him back again. Pure in a lot of trouble. There's the flash, but he's too low already. His soul is able to get there for the taunt. They're going to catch OQ as well. Nice explosive cast from Catch, and that's going to be two kills. Soul picks that one up.
Wow.
That is how you handle Najin early game.
Yeah, Duke not able to answer that teleport play, and they catch out Pure with the flash. Once Secret's flash comes back up from that mid lane play, not aware of that timing. And now Spenu actually going to take a dragon off of this. So the lane dominance from Najin has pretty much been broken this game. Spenu just skirmishing better, and they set up a great Stand United.
Wow. And it looks like we may be having a little bit of divine intervention already in this game against Najin. They're up 4-1 in kills. They do lose their top turret. But and the funny thing is Najin is actually still ahead in gold. Probably because of that turret. And because of a bit of CS as well. Obviously Duke ahead in that department. But with the assist, Soul's not too far behind. Sawson finds Watch and does a lot of damage.
Yeah, Watch peeking in right there, but does end up taking a combo to the face from the Victor. OQ opting for an Avarice Blade in this laning phase, so starting to stack up some more gold. And look at that, Nuclear catching back up in terms of CS, so now he definitely has a large gold lead, a large advantage, should hit that Trinity Force early.
It's kind of looking that way. It's weird to see OQ die like that. That was odd.
Well, I think you're preying on their tendencies, though. This is a lane that likes to all in. And well, Shen is a powerful tool against people who have that style. We've seen even SK Telecom be flustered by CJ Entis's Shen and the double globals. When you can run Stand United and the teleport, it really does dictate the way that you play the game on Najin. You have to go after the Shen. You have to.
Well, it's like we said earlier, too. I mean, Spenu knows that Najin is strong in the early game, so you just want to try to fight fire with fire here. And either, you know, one of two things happen. Either they beat you, and, well, hey, at least you tried the best thing you could have. But if you beat them, then you're going against a team that doesn't have the strongest mid and late game. You need that kind of edge if you're going to beat Najin.
Yeah, and to be fair to Najin, now we have seen them make some adjustments when it comes to their late game. Against Samsung, they played a very even game, but actually won the game by out-rotating Samsung and having better shot calling, which is not really a way Najin has won games before. Basically, if they didn't just stomp the laning phase, they would have a delayed teleport from Duke, not be all on the same page when it came to grouping for an objective. But Najin has cleaned up a lot and showed that at least they could win games from slightly behind.
Yeah. That is an important thing going into the playoffs as well, too. It looks like it's going to be another attempt to dive. Purinoku backing off enough, and Tibbers used just for the disengage. They're going to lose their turret for it, though, but Najin going on in this tier 2 and top.
It's a good move by Spenu.
Yeah.
They know they can't lane against Duke's Gnar with this Black Cleaver. So instead, they just commit to the bottom side. Pure gets a nice Tibbers off just to stop the Shen from getting in range of a taunt. And they're going to trade a tier 2 for a tier 1. So Najin comes out ahead. Watch not trying to stop that. And instead, moving forward to take a more important objective. So solid response there from Najin Empire.
It works out every step of the way. When Spenu takes something, Najin just takes a little bit more.
Yeah. And it's a very, very long and scary lane now if Sol wants to go in there. Remember, attack the Shen because he is the one with multiple globals. So if you can get him pushed all the way up to your tier 1, then you have so much control over that topside jungle of Spenu that you can gank him. They're going to send Nuclear in secret there instead. They want to use this early Trinity Force to keep on pushing down these turrets. And Duke may not have the wave clear or the tankiness to get through this. OQ now wants to push down onto Sol. Sol, of course, has the Sunfire Cape, so he will be resistant to what OQ wants to do.
Yeah, it's not going to stop OQ from getting a decent amount of damage done to this turret, though. Watch coming down. They want to dive this, but Sol already backing away.
That's fine. If you trade that tower right now, Najin, they will maintain a slight gold lead, and you're trading during the point where Corki is the strongest.
They're going to try to steal this red buff, too, it looks like. Sol, I don't think you can stop that one, buddy.
Okay, are they going to go for another one? Definitely a possibility. No one's going back. OQ finally going back. They know secrets there. They saw him from behind.
They saw catch as well, too. And Duke could be in a little bit of trouble here, getting very, very low. Tries to flash. There we go. Catch there to stop him. Another nice dive from Spenu.
Yeah, Spenu's really making the dives and the aggressive plays work this game. They knew that there wasn't a possibility of anybody else being there, so why not go ahead, take out this very squishy Gnar? And this is the pitfall of building that Black Cleaver first.
Yeah, and I was wondering if we were going to see an engage from Pure there. He's got the Tibbers, he's got the Flash. Gunga was making his way up, but he's going to have to turn around.
Now, interestingly, Sasin has a lot of damage onto the mid lane turret already.
Yeah, this is usually kind of the opposite of what we saw, well, in our first match of the night, actually. He's here normally with the edge in lane.
Yeah, but that early gank really helping turn the lane on its head. Now Sasin in a very favorable situation. And can they continue to take down these turrets? We're not actually going to see Nuclear swap into mid. That is a bit of a surprise.
Not yet, I guess, yeah. Sasin actually is a big threat in the late game, too, on this Victor.
Yeah, massive.
Yeah, you really can't... Sasin specifically, though, too. He is, you know, definitely the star of this team, and you don't want him rolling early, even if you are Najin. So it looks like we're going to have the duos in bot lane again.
Yep, so they decide not to push mid. Instead, they shove the wave to get control before the dragon. Spenu already with a great ward setup. Spenu playing some really nice League of Legends tonight.
Yeah, really over the last month or so, Spenu has made some pretty large strides in terms of their team play and decision-making in game, and it's paid off. It got them a match win against Jhinair, and it's made them look fairly decent in nearly all their games.
Okay, so they are trying to prevent Najin from getting into the river. Can't quite accomplish that feat. Are they just going to push down onto the mid lane turret? 5-1 up in terms of kills, but nearly dead even when it comes to gold.
Yeah. Now it's all about the dragon. Najin really wants to take their first. Tie things up that way. They may have to give up the mid lane turret to do it. Well, it looks like they push it back enough now, and Spenu committing to the river instead.
Yeah, and he's really dangerous in that pink ward brush.
Yeah. They're going to try to zone her out. Dragon started by Najin.
Oh, they have to be
Spenu.
Really careful about Annie and Azir.
Yes, they do. They're going to go in anyway. Secret engaging along with Kat Shen, ulting down into it. OQ very low from the beginning. He has to get out of the fight, but he gets a good angle. Dragon taken by Spenu during the middle of all that. And they get a double kill on a Nuclear. They win the fight. They take the Dragon. And Najin suddenly not ahead in gold after that one.
And Pure using both of his summoners to engage that fight, but the follow-up wasn't there. Goong on the side was zoned off by Sasin, and this Corki that is so strong right now continues to get rolling when it comes to kills. Spen who steals the dragon. It was about 1,000 HP when that fight started, and it was a split call from Najin.
Man, they tried to get the taunt onto Goong. They got a lot of damage to him either way. Chilling Smite used onto Soul. That tier 2 in mid already nearly dead. Najin needs to turn things around in a hurry, otherwise they are going to be in big trouble.
Yeah, Duke,
he's not Meganar, though, and Secret's just going to keep knocking him back. They're like, all right, come on.
He will be soon, and there aren't enough ults to stop this. They're just going to dive it.
Goong gets a kill there. Soul dodges the stunt, doesn't dodge a knockup from Watch, and there's some kills coming in from Najin now.
Not going to be enough damage onto Watch, but they return that pressure with another couple of kills, and now they're going to answer with the turret. So Spenu overextending a little bit, not respecting the fact that Duke could just come back in and get into Meganar form, threaten that ultimate one more time. Yeah. And so Najin mitigates some of the damage done, though they still find themselves 1K behind when the dust settles.
What a brawl this game has been early on. It's been awesome.
Yeah, still worth it for Spenu, though. Of course, two mid lane towers down now, so they've opened up so much of the map, and now a roaming Victor is a real possibility, and that is something that is extremely difficult to deal with. Duke frantically trying to get tankier and tankier.
Oku's starting to put that Infinity Edge to work, though. He got one kill in the last fight, and if they're not careful, they could just start to see Oku tear their team apart, too. Even in that dragon fight, Oku got out and was able to get a decent amount of damage done.
Yeah, the problem is that Catch already building towards a Frozen Heart, Soul already with armor, and he's a core item behind Nuclear. He is really so far behind. Five kills to just one, and he fell behind in CS2.
Well, Nuclear is ultra fed this game. 5-1-1. As you mentioned, already has that Blade of the Rune King. And he's a talented AD carry, so he's not been wasting that money yet.
No. And it looks like why he has a null magic mantle this game. That is
Hex Drinker. I don't know.
A bit curious.
Maybe
he could be going for an early QSS. That's definitely a possibility because he's so far ahead.
Yeah, that you know.
He probably is to get rid of any stun and make sure that he will continue to use his lead during team fights without any possibility of getting blown up.
Yeah, the Tibra stun from Annie, the Gnar ultimate, these are things that having an early QSS would be pretty good against.
Well, all he has to do is QSS the Annie stun because at that point he could just Valk out and the Gnar ult will not hit him. So that is a huge bonus to not eating a ton of follow-up CC.
Not a lot of vision for Spenu in the enemy jungle, as our observer was just showing us. Meanwhile, Najin has a lot of deep wards on the top part of the map right now.
Yeah, they definitely know what's going on. They're not so far behind that they can't fight. Secret wants to clear out the Baron pit. Najin needs to make sure that they keep eyes on that objective. With Spenu already finishing a blade, there is always the possibility that that can be snuck if they're not particularly careful.
You know, the way Gragas is like bald on top and he's got a huge beard and like long hair, it's kind of like he's wearing a hair poncho. You know, hangs down in the front and the back.
Except
doesn't really cover much of your head.
Only the top part of his head shows instead of his entire head.
That's a kind of like it.
Would you wear a hair poncho?
No. There was probably some monk in the Middle Ages that did that. Hair shirts were like all the rage with the Franciscans back in the day, you know?
Yeah, they really loved that. The suffering brought them closer to God, I guess.
Hey man, hair shirts, sometimes you just gotta make a fashion statement too. It's true. I went to a CC in Italy, saw a hair shirt, didn't look comfortable. It was also hundreds of years old, so that probably would have made it less comfortable too.
I don't know, maybe it's softened in its age.
maybe. Just like put it through the washer with some Downy, it'll be feel great. Gunning for that Downy sponsorship, oh yeah.
All right, well, Najin here has a ton of pink wards for this next dragon. Their hope would be to catch somebody out because fighting is still an option, but definitely a less attractive one, especially considering this Corki now has the QSS. Going to be really, really hard to stop Nuclear from doing a boatload of damage.
You know, I have flashbacks to a recent game where OQ was playing Corki and found himself in a similar situation, and a Corki that is this far ahead can be pretty explosive in terms of turning things around. Najin pushing up his mid lane,
good
though.
Good call. Get control over mid, then collapse onto the tier 2. Will delay that dragon. Any delay is so valuable at this point because the first dragon came very early.
Second dragon coming very soon. Najin in a pretty good position to try to take it.
Najin really, really needs this dragon because they have to slow down the pace of this game.
Yeah, they need a really good engagement from Pure here.
You do not want to be dealing with 35-minute 5 dragon from Spenu.
No. Well, that doesn't sound like a lot of fun. That sounds like less fun than a hair shirt.
That should be your catchphrase.
That sounds like it's less fun than a hair shirt, guys. Oh, Rek'Sai coming in on his jet ski. As you do.
I'm a bit surprised they didn't go for that. Duke is on the cusp of hitting that Mega Gnar. They had the Azir turret in the mid lane.
He still is. Oh, it's going to be the engage. They find Sasa, but can they finish him off? Gear gets very low in the meantime as well, too. That's another kill for Soul. Catch gets taken out, though. There we go. Goong picks one up. Ember's Divide pushes Soul back, and it might be looking good for Najin. No. Double kill for Soul, though. Najin. Wow, here comes Nuclears in the middle of everything. Gets ulted. A big ult for Duke. And now the kills start coming in from Najin. One for Duke, one for Goong. And it's a battle of the mid laners, and Goong takes it. Never mind. There goes Soul. There's the ace. Double kill for Duke. And that is the danger of Najin the Empire in the early game.
Oh, man. So many mistakes from Spenu right there. First off, why did Najin engage that? The answer is because Corki was not with the rest of the team and Spenu was posturing far too aggressively. You have to respect the fact that there's an Annie in this game.
Yeah.
Sasuke was in the River Brush. It was an easy collapse from Najin onto the Victor. Sure, he survived. Soul was very fast with the Shen Shield, but Nuclear took a long time to get there. And then when he did, he Valks straight into the Gnar. You have to respect Gnar's damage at the very least right now. Just pursue him from range. Don't go into Mega Gnar. Oh my, this is...
Let's watch it again. Lately, it seems
like... Look at where Corki is. He's nowhere near this team fight. They get 3 damage down onto Sasen. Annie dies, but it doesn't matter because Annie's already done her job. They get catch. Okay, well, they're trying to box people out with this. Now, watch Nuclear here. I don't even know why you would Valk in like that. Because
the
QSS works, but if you're in melee range of a Gnar with Black Cleaver, you are going to eat damage. And you are not a tank. So, had Nuclear not Valked so aggressively, I think even though it was a great initiation from Najin and a great timing for them, Spenu had a chance to win that team fight simply because Sasen survived the initial blast.
Yep, that was a good old-fashioned Goong maneuver there to use your movement ability to get into the middle of the most dangerous people on the other team.
You mean OQ?
That was also, well, OQ, it's too early in the game to call it an OQ. An early game move like that is called a Goong.
Ah, okay.
Of course, or Woong, rather, Woong. Not Goong, Woong. In honor of the CJ AD carry way back when. Goong doesn't really do that.
Okay, well, they got the dragon. That is of huge importance to Najin's ability to come back into this game. They picked a very smart fight. And now Najin wants to at least threaten this Baron.
Oh, fail flash from Pure. Oops.
They
caught catch at least. And the culling with the Shen Shield is not enough. Duke gets a kill there, and now Secret. There we go. There's the catch Annie was looking for. They're going to be able to take him out. Duke with the backline. Big Gnarl brings in Sasen. And Najin, the kills are starting to come again. That's another big team fight for Najin. And seems like things are kind of falling apart for Spenu here as Najin turns right around for that Baron.
Yeah, not the best Annie ult because it was just immediately cleansed off by the Alistar ultimate. But the catch there was good. And catch, speaking of, just overcommitted to that when they didn't have any option. Najin had no longer a choice of how to engage. It was kind of gifted to them wrapped up with a bow. And Ketch also, I'm not sure if he had the explosive cask up at the time.
Yep, and Najin didn't even give them the receipt, so they can't return it.
I'm sure they'd like to return a couple of these team fights this game.
Probably. Things were very even, and then the team fights happened. And Najin got an ace, Najin got kills, and
it's so sad
Najin gets a big lead.
Uh-oh.
Oh, they're going in on Nuclear, and Nuclear tries to Velk away. It's pretty low health. Can they catch him here? Catch and Secret coming in to save their AD carry, and it looks like for now, they can.
Yeah, just backing off right there. Didn't get the catch, so don't play too aggressively. Just fall back and use the Baron as best you can. They don't have great side wave control right now, so that means that OQ and Duke are just forced to back off for the time being and set up these waves to start pushing in the opposite direction. It's like a bit of a slow push set up there by OQ, but he's just going to waltz immediately to the next wave as the tower cleans it up. So never mind, just pushing as fast as he can.
And OQ is caught up, more or less, in items here. Looking a bit better now. Still about a pickaxe behind, but he's got three damage items, whereas Nuclear is still sitting on the Triforce and the Blade and the QSS.
And this is where the QSS
falls off a bit.
Yeah, falls off because you didn't keep the snowball up.
Yeah, you can't buy a second item QSS and then die like that in a team fight.
Third item. He had the blade first.
Third item, yeah.
Yes, agreed. You can't make those kind of positional mistakes when you are the one who needs to carry the game. QSS is great. It just gives you more survivability to carry, but very poor decisions in the team fights from Nuclear.
Yeah, pretty much.
I was so excited about Spenio. I was like, wow, they're playing so well. And
Me too, man. A couple
of these team fights happen, and it's just a disaster.
It hurts my heart. You know what a big fan I am of this team. Oh, Spenio, why? Sadshoes.jpg.
I don't think anybody's made that one yet.
Yeah. It hurts my soul. See, that's a double punt because it's a joke for Soul on the team and a joke for Souls, which is part of the shoot.
Thank you for explaining your puns, Soa.
You're welcome.
Would you like to do that for all future puns that you use?
No, I don't think you usually need to, but I thought that one, you know, because it was a double pun, it needed a little bit.
Yeah.
The elusive double pun.
All right, so another dragon.
Soul.
Set up here. Duke is just such a problem now because he has enough armor and magic resist to be relevant against both Sasan and Nuclear.
Well, Sasan really wants his blue buff, and they are going to fight for it. I think Duke's going to have to let this one go. I think Duke, yeah, got away. There we go. Sasan gets the blue buff. Here comes the rest of Najin, though. They don't have any Baron remaining at this point.
Now, great vision control, just popping a few more wards in. Push the wave before they go right over to the dragon. They will have eyes on absolutely everything as this dragon goes down.
Yeah. This will tie up the dragons for Najin, and that puts him in a pretty good position. That was really the only thing they were behind on yet in this game, these dragons. And now they've got their second one.
Well, another game where Najin is behind, has to play from behind, and they make it work. And sure, there were very large mistakes from Spenu this game, such as posturing too aggressively at the dragon when there's an Annie on the enemy team and your Corki's at the bottom lane. But frankly, Najin picking up on that and then pulling the trigger is new for them. It's not like they have been having this level of shot calling. And I'm not going to say it's such impressive shot calling or anything like that, but the fact that they are even able to hit that stage right now shows that they are developing as a team.
Dude, that's because Worlds is coming up. It's happening.
The Worlds buff.
It's Worlds time, man.
Watch this
suddenly,
here.
Mysteriously, areas of their play that have been a problem for the entire year are improving. Strange.
It's also great to see that a player like Goom, who has such a hard time adopting new champions, is playing well on Azir and Victor. Sure, he died, but he hasn't died since that one death in the laning phase.
Yeah. It's not been too bad. And what do you do if you're Spenu? I mean, you're going to need to find picks at this point, aren't you?
Yeah. Baron up in 2 minutes, obviously. Najin just wants to take that objective. Don't overcommit to anything right now. They have good wave clear, so wait for the Baron to come up, get the wards down, farm as best you can, then just go for it and close out the game that way.
Pretty much. Doing the split push down in the bot lane against Soul. He's already got the tier 2 long out of the way. Only the inhibitor hurts remaining in all the lanes at this point. Trying to clear out some wards, but Najin should be very, very ready for this Baron.
Yep, popping that Azir turret, keeping everything pushed forward. They're just really not giving any chance at all to get wards into the side of the jungle. Should make for a very easy Baron bait or quick take from Najin EMfire. Nice setup already coming through.
Pretty much.
So here we go, just stick around by that Azir turret for as long as possible so it doesn't burn down too quickly. And then fall back, and it's just a giant, scary, dark forest that Spenu has to walk through to get to that objective now. Finally trying to get some wards, and they got 30 seconds to do it. But this has been really methodically played out. I like the timing on that Azir turret. Good.
Yeah, it really did just kind of stymie the ability of Spenu to get any semblance of vision back in their own jungle.
And now they're scared.
Yeah.
They don't know where three people are right now.
No,
and that is
very,
terrifying.
Very
they see Pure, but if they get too close, either they are going to lose Alistar ult because they get hit by a stun, or it's going to be it. Catch right now, trying to get some wards over the wall. Vision in the brush with the barrel. Here we go.
Sasan chilling smite onto him. They're going to use a Shen out right away here, pushing Pure away. And Watch getting in the middle of everything. Catch gets the kill onto Watch. Duke trying to get in the back lines. Where's the Meganar? There it is. Swiping Soul against the wall. He needed more than that, though. And Najin with an awkward team fight here. Can they make it work? Catch very, very low. If they can kill him, might be able to get this Baron, but I don't know. That was a bit awkward by Najin.
It was. It was a bit awkward, but also credit to Catch. The reason why Najin didn't win that team fight was because Pure was knocked away after the engage from Rek'Sai. Now, should you Chilling Smite and then unburrow, initiate a fight when you have an Annie on your team? No, you should not do that, Watch. Please don't do that. Let Annie initiate and then follow up. But Pure's follow up was just crushed by Catch.
Watch is like, no worries, guys. I've got my ult. Here, see, I'm back. It's like I was never gone.
Yeah, and it's also not that impactful. 30-second depth timer and the Void Rush doesn't really change a whole lot. They're going to be back before the Stand United or the Unbreakable Will is there.
Yeah, there's just no vision for Spenu. They know the Baron is going down, but they can't really stop it. They're going to try to come in anyway. Catch has his ultimate back again. There we go, and they're going to catch. Catch gets blown up immediately. There's another kill for Goong, and Najin with this Baron. Looks like they're ready to try to take some inhibitors.
But that's the advantage. They set up vision so well previously that it didn't even matter if they lost their jungler and it was a 4v5 because Spenu was still terrified of what lay waiting for them in that jungle, and there was no way for them to contest the Baron. So the Najin planning really well in advance. It buys them a lot of time to get that Baron, and now they're going to take an inhibitor.
It's going to be a very easy inhibitor as well, too. No contest at all. Culling just used to push Sasan back. Secret gets the body block a little bit of it. But Najin seems to be ready to start cruising to a win here, and I don't mean on Rek'Sai's ultimate.
Well, they could do that, too.
They could.
You can cruise to any place of Summoner's Rift, including to kill your opponent's Nexus if you have a tunnel there already.
I suppose.
Have you been jet skiing?
I've never been jet skiing, no.
Neither have I.
Oh, interesting. No,
it's actually the opposite of interesting because neither of us have done it, Doa.
I did way more exciting things than jet ski.
Because
who needs a jet
how
ski?
Is it interesting? We have no experience doing it. There's nothing to share.
Well, no, it's interesting that we both haven't done it.
I see.
You know?
Is it?
A little bit. Not really. Trying to build the hype, you know?
Jet ski hype.
Yeah. Jet ski hype. Just trying to promote the pool party skins, man. Just doing my part, right?
Ryan thanks you, sir.
Sure they do.
Great. They were discovered. They didn't want to go after the Banshee's Veil Gnar right there.
I guess not.
not the juiciest target for a pick. Watch.
Split push Rek'Sai. He's got his ultimate, so he can get back when they need him.
Also, he can't engage before the rest of his team, so double win.
Yeah. Ultimate used. He's back. And Najin trying to take this, what would be their third dragon. Duke gets caught, takes a ton of damage, and Spinu's going to move in. They get the dragon catch, was able to get it. Nice explosive cast, pushes Gear back into it. He's going to be very, very low, but a lot of low health members on Spinu right now somehow. Oh, Pure didn't quite make it. I thought he was going to make it. Nuclear a bit low. Culling doing damage, body blocking, a double kill for OQ already. And Najin, they want more. A kill, though, comes in for Sasan. Sasan, though, finally caught by Goong. Can they finish him off? Looks like probably yes. Watch comes in. And there we go. Watch flashes for the engage, and he wants that kill.
Well, why the hell not? Duke is searching for Soul right now, but they still have three members left. Long death timers coming in. And that is one Nexus turret already destroyed. Soul frantically swiping away at these super minions. That is not the person you want to do that. Goon just going to pop over the wall. Baron buff still on Najin, so this should be the end of the game.
It is indeed the end of the game. There goes the second Nexus turret. And Najin, after a shaky start, will be able to take the game despite all these knockups coming in from Secret. There's an R ultimate. Use the force, Duke. That's a win for Najin here in game number one.
That was one of your better ones. Well done, sir.
Thank you.
Saving that one. So, Spenu played really well in the early part of that game, didn't they?
And they did make a lot of mistakes, it's true. Especially Nuclear misplayed his advantage, and the rest of his team wasn't respectful enough after, I think they got a little bit overhyped after doing so well in the early game, but props to them, they played the map well early, but Najin too. Played the comeback game really well. I like what we saw from them around that Baron. Great use of the Azir turret. Najin now showing they can make comebacks. Sure, it's against the bottom team in this league, but what these Najin sub players have to offer us.
And there's the Jarvan ban. Okay, so sticking with that. Jarvan ban from game number one, and the Kalista ban.
Just have to get that away from OQ. There's no way you can give him that champion. Now they take out the Shen, one of the major problems in that last game for them.
Yep.
And the TF ban actually on the red side here. Normally a blue side ban because you can just last pick it and have some advantages, but that is Tank.
Well, TF is the only champion that Tank played last season that's still in the meta right now, so.
Well, he's going to have a lot of other champions. He can play that.
Course,
it's not
really
going to be an issue. Tank actually got a pentakill on Xerath in his first professional game. That was pretty fun to see.
And then he immediately changed his name from Rain to Tank. And there's the Ryze ban. So again, Najin just avoiding that Ryze. What's the last ban for Spenu going to be?
Will it be that Elise, actually? And yes, it will be.
Yeah, okay. And so first pick over to Najin. Do you just go with the Rek'Sai? Do you just get something safe for Peanut here?
Yes, I would definitely get something for Peanut that is strong. They could get the Victor for Tank. That is, in fact, what they are going to pick up. So Victor first picked on blue side in both of our games tonight. Spenu grabbed it in the last draft, so they know they prioritized it. Sasan had a good laning phase. He got a kill on the Goon with the help of his teammates, and that really turned that lane around.
Yeah. So if you're Spenu, later on, do you just grab that Azir?
You could definitely do that if they want to play a more control-based pressure style.
So I say Rek'Sai, Gragas perhaps for catch instead. Had a couple good plays last game. It wasn't bad.
Yeah, he did okay on that champion. Certainly helped out pretty significantly in the early game. And I do not think you should take Fizz this early on in the draft if you are Spenu.
Oh boy, you could flex it, I guess, but...
Yeah, it's going to be an R instead, Lock that safety pick in. Yeah. Good in so many different lane matchups, just very, very safe. You have the Gragas already there to provide your engage. Now, Najin, I don't see why you wouldn't just go for Annie again right here. Just take
it. Why not? Yeah. Maybe Annie Corki here?
Nah.
Annie Lucian, too.
I take a jungler and Annie.
Okay.
Take Alistar. Take that one away from Secret. I actually like that pick a lot because it removes it from Secret. And Secret has been the most consistent on Alistair. It's also a very forgiving champion because if you can always just get out with your ultimate if you mess up a combo.
Yeah. Now, Peanut did place in Nidalee last season.
Yeah, perfect so champion for Peanut, too. We think about Peanut.
Right, we could see it.
Very mechanical player. This is pre-Nidalee nerfs, of course. We're on patch 5.14, so they don't have to consider those coming into play. They're actually going to blind pick the Lucian.
Oh, and then the Kog'Maw goes in immediately for Spenu. Great. And so what is it going to be? Probably just grab your support here.
Yep, save your mid laner for last. You already know what their mid laner is. I suppose you could take the mid, but there's not a lot of issues with your support right now.
Or the Maokai.
No,
last,
I think
pick your support.
Braum is still available here.
There we go.
Yeah, you want Braum against the Lucian. You can block the culling.
It's true. So the final two picks over to Najin right now. They need a top laner and they need a jungler. Theory.
I'm actually surprised that they would blind pick Lucian. We know Spenu likes to play Kog'Maw. They've played it a lot. They play Juggernaut compositions. And that's still a big possibility here, right? They could last pick the Lulu in the lane and try for a Juggernaut one more time. They have excellent peel for a Juggernaut.
They do.
Now, we have seen Yasuo as an answer to top lane Gnar. Strangely
and
enough.
We have seen Duke play it too.
So when you have that top lane Gnar, basically, if you have a Yasuo in the top side, you can block his boomerang with the wind wall, and then he doesn't actually get the cooldown refund from catching it, and then you just get all over him, get through the minion wave, start just attacking him mercilessly. It's an exciting matchup, but it will be the Hecarim.
All right, and it will be the Nidalee as well for Peanut.
Yeah, I'm not sure about this Nidalee pick. There's not a lot of synergy. Why not just take the Maokai if you're going to have Nidalee so you increase the synergy and your ability to gank the top side? Obviously, Duke can't carry as hard on that champion, but Hecarim versus the Gnar could be a difficult matchup for the Hecarim. He takes so much time to ramp up. And Gnar is so good against Hecarim because you can build Frozen Mallet, and the Hecarim can never really do anything. He can't close that gap to trade. He will be infinitely kited in the laning phase.
It is bizarre to see that Hecarim locked in, but maybe they just want a good way to get in onto this Kog'Maw. I mean, obviously, Braum is not going to stop that Hecarim unless he ults him. If you go with the Malzahar, you can subdue him, but it will be the Lulu for the Juggernaut.
Yes, okay. The Juggernaut. Now,
and this is a comp that Spenu can play.
Yep. They lost their last time that they tried to use the Juggernaut, but it's not surprising they lose most of their games.
Yeah.
It's not the best comp to play Juggernaut because Hecarim and Alistair are in here. There's a lot of potential to get onto the Kog'Maw.
And those Nidalee spears are long range too, so one of those hits nuclear to soften him up, and then all the engage happens. It could get rough for nuclear pretty quick.
Indeed it could. So taking a look at these lineups, I'm really happy to see Peanut on this Nidalee. Should be really exciting. Should be interesting to see too how Tank compares on Victor when we look at Goong instead. Of course, Goong has been doing a lot of very nice work on Victor recently, but Peanut's ganking on Nidalee. I am excited, Doa.
Yeah,
I really liked watching him play Rengar.
If you thought the last game was aggressive early on, I think this one's going to be pretty action-packed as well, too, which is exactly what I want out of, well, really any match, I suppose, I have to admit. And we'll see if Najin can get that 2-0. They've already knocked Jhinair out of the playoffs with a win in game number one. Can they get a 2-0 to put themselves possibly a little bit farther ahead in their own playoff race? It's time, guys. Najin versus Spenu. Let's get in the game and see who takes it. And welcome once again. Summoner's Rift, Spenu's Sonic Boom versus Najin and Peanut's Legion of Girl Fans.
The Peanut Legion. We call them the peanut gallery.
That was clever. Yes. It's a loud butterfly.
So, just a fan this game? No.
Many fans this game.
Many fans this game.
Oh, you meant in the game.
In the game, too. Indeed. And
I don't know what that is, but it's creepy.
I am afraid of that thing.
Wow. More nightmare fuel.
All right, well, Duke and Peanut going for a bit of double jungling early on their red side of the map. OQ and Pure get their preferred. Oh, they're not. It's actually going to be a lane swap, so a recall from Spenu will send Braum and Kog'Maw into the top side, and now they're going to respond by attempting to jungle on the weak side, starting with the buff. So we'll see if OQ leaves to get a freeze here, whether that is going to be Alistair's work.
I wonder. It seems like Najin is really looking for this 2v2.
Well, they didn't try too hard when it comes to warding, and dodging out of OQ's 2v2 does seem relatively obvious. So they are going to get the freeze down as we take a look at Dongjun. And Caster John, our green casters.
He's really the caster version of Peanut, according to a lot of fans. Yes. So, the mid lane.
Land of the poke. So, Sazen just going for a similar wave clear, unless Peanut decides to go in. I don't think we're going to be seeing much action there. Pure making his way slowly through the jungle alongside Peanut right now. And let's check and see out how these waves are going. Looks like with Peanut and Pure already on the top side of the map to balance out. Oh, there he goes. That is that's from his military days, looks like.
Dongjun is known for being one of the guys that twirls the fake gun around. That was his job in the military.
Yeah, he was like a rifle twirler. It's actually really funny to talk to him about it.
He's really embarrassed. It's
he
hilarious.
Is really embarrassed about it. But I asked him, why were you chosen for that job? And he was like, well, I was tall and good looking, so a general picked me to twirl rifles
just
for
just out of
years.
A lineup. It's like, you look like a man who should be twirling a rifle instead of fighting. Yep. Oh, tank. A bit low there.
Yeah, Dongjun was also a professional Brood War player at one time. So
that's right. Long ago.
Long ago. His ID was actually rookie, interestingly enough.
Well, what do you know? Sazen could be in trouble here. Oh, boy. Yeah, he looks like he's in trouble. There's a death ray coming through. Sazen's going to need to flash over the wall to get away from this one. And even then, I think it's unlikely
here
to try to do something to tank. Duke coming in. He's like, mock me for picking Hecarim, will you? First blood taken by tank anyway.
That is just a four-man push onto the mid lane. Don't expect the Hecarim to be there, but what can he do? He's a melee champion against a freezing Kog'Maw, so you might as well just wander off and get an assist after you push the wave forward. Meanwhile, OQ here, whoa, and it's dive central. Goodbye!
Yep. And the Peanut show has begun. We're going pure Peanut.
And, oh, we didn't even mention this. Lulu has teleport this game. So,
oh, you're right.
I think that's actually very smart from Spenu, because when we think about how they got a lead in the last game, they were using the double globals. Peanut's like, oh, yeah. Peanut's a very cocky player. His interviews are hilarious most of the time. So.
Yes. He's known to have a bit of the old attitude. That's for sure. But the fangirls dig a bad boy, you know? Bad boy Peanut with the jungle middle.
Great dive there from Pure.
Yep, that's right. Pure picking that one up.
Had the ignite.
That's how you steal the kills, man.
That's how you bloodthirsty support properly.
That's right.
If only you could take ignite twice.
You know, back in the day. That's right. That's what I was always hoping. Back in the day when Lulu's E did like a ton of damage, I used to just build AP on support Lulu and then like nuke people for 1,000 damage ease to steal every kill. It was great. No Krugs, sorry. Man, Pure and Peanut just really have become this commando team delving deep into the enemy jungle for fame and fortune.
Yeah, they also shouldn't be allowed to do that on their weak side. No. That is not a place that they should be right now, actually. that with Secret down on the bottom side, they have a lot of freedom. Not really any major CS leads developing for Najin right now, but they got that 1,000 gold advantage. Lots of assists, couple of kills will do that for them. And I guess the minions are going to...
Oh, wow. Bring it all the way to the bottom lane. Oh. That minion, someone's going to have to like go after him. He's not allowed to go that far.
Well, at that point, though, you know exactly where
Welcome
the wards
back.
Are. That was a nice journey, but guess what, minion?
Oh, it was
Why'd
a great
you
vacation.
Come back? Why'd you come back? Now you just get to die.
I like it. He just immediately gets back to work, though, you know? So I gotta fight this.
Like lambs to the slaughter.
That's right.
You escaped temporarily, minion.
That's what they're made for. It's really dark, really. Really, really, really. I've used up my quota of the word really today.
I'll hold you to that.
Thanks. Gotta think of synonyms.
Very?
Indubitably?
Yes, there is no doubt here.
Massively.
So, Peanut now just trying to sweep a brush. They want to prey on Sossin. Sossin did not use his flash in that last engagement, so...
Yeah,
he's got that. I mean, there was no escaping from that particular scenario. Duke actually having an okay time farming underneath his turret, surprisingly enough.
Well,
OQ just chasing this Braum-Gnar combo around. Not sure that he's quite that threatening with just a Doran's Blade, but
he wants to try to bait here. And will he be able to do it? Pierre's like,
he doesn't have enough damage to actually kill Sol in secret.
Yeah.
Sol's already been able to go back and shop and pick up a Ruby Crystal.
With the 3v2, you know, maybe something could happen, but I don't think Sol and Secret are going to take the bait.
That was actually a big waste of time. There was pretty much no kill pressure there. Two flashes up.
Yeah.
It's just not anything you're going to be able to do. So it seems to me that Pure and Peanut are getting a little too excited.
Oh, Sossin, the all-in coming in from Tank. That Chaos Storm not doing a ton of damage. Or really much of any damage.
It's worth noting that Najin's B team has been doing really well in the Korean Challenger League. They have a strong backup roster.
Well, that's a good start so far for the backups of Tank and Peanut. Well, Fnatic Gragas, I haven't seen that one for a while.
Usually it's Fnatic Janna who's played here.
Yeah, that's right.
They like that skin for some reason.
They do. Either that or it's Hextech Janna, I think.
The steampunk Janna one?
Yeah, that's right.
What is a Hextech anyway? What is a
Hextech? It's like magic combined with technology, you know?
What is the number, what does the hex, the six, have to do with?
I think it's more hex like this. You cast a hex on someone, you know, like a spell. Oh.
Yep.
And I think Sol may feel like he's cursed as well. As the tower dive comes in, teleport activated though. Lulu coming up. Catch very low and Peanut.
Yeah, catch no mana right there.
Yep.
No HP. He has to get out. Peanut is still sitting here.
They can still dive this.
The TP, yeah. Sossin used his TP, canceled it.
Oh, walked right into a spear and Sol knocked back under his own turret. But here comes the onslaught of shadows and Duke picks up his first kill of the game.
Yeah, a little bit sloppy there when it comes to hitting all of those abilities.
Yeah,
but they make it work in the end, and they know Catch can't be there. So smart dive, Lulu TP down. Catch was just chased off. They see everybody else, and here comes the TP.
Yeah.
Duke right into the bottom lane just to defend the tower. Otherwise, OQ sitting down there. Just a bit of a sitting duck.
He's got a Sheen so far. That's about it for Duke.
Yeah, the Braum pick, just such a great selection against the Lucian. Does shut down some of his lane bully potential. One wonders a bit about early picking Lucian in the current meta while the Kog'Maw and the Braum are still available.
Yeah, I saw on Reddit he was really weak, so big risk by Najin.
He's good in a lot of the laning matchups with AD carries. That's why people pick him. He doesn't have that same late game damage that he used to, but use him as a lane bully, he can be quite powerful, and there's no denying that he's excellent at poking people off of objectives if you're really good at landing the culling.
Yeah. That is a lot of time what it does hinge on, is being able to channel most of your culling into somebody who's defending a turret, and they're going to go after Peanut. Peanut is not deterred, though.
Not going to hit his spear.
Peanut just really, really wants more kills.
If we think about Braum against this composition, he can block the Nidalee spears, he can block the Death Ray, he can block the Culling. This is an excellent pick against what they're facing.
Yeah, for
and
sure.
And the Kog'Maw and Braum have such natural synergy
because you hit
the Winter's Bite, and then you can proc it from such an insanely long way away with the Bio-Arcane Barrage from Kog'Maw.
True enough.
But they have to get this Juggernaut rolling. Now, fortunately, the Kog'Maw has not been held back in all of this. If we think about where Najin have been making the plays, it's been on the mid and the top lane.
Well, Ketch's coming in. Pyranokyu might be in the danger because they have no support from Peanut right now. Pure pushes Catch away. Going to need more than that, though. Looks like they're going to be okay. I guess they didn't need more than that.
Surprised Ketch didn't ult right there.
Yeah, that's what I was kind of expecting. That's why I was getting ready for it. Oh, well.
Of course, Alistar had his ult too, so there's probably no way to kill Alistar. Maybe he just wants to save it.
You feel like he could have at least pushed Oku back and forced the summoner, right?
Do you like dives, Noah?
I love dives. Soul trying to live, though. Trying to stay alive through the dive. Duke taking some turret hits, but he manages to make it work, and Peanut picks up another kill.
Yeah, not a lot of tankiness there yet. Duke just building straight into that Trinity Force. Yep, that's Soul looking sad that he has
Soul
been
crushed.
Soul crushed.
Yep.
Been targeted repeatedly this game for the dives. But
that is a heavily worn Soul right there.
That's how you make the Hecarim work. You have to get him ahead early. I'm actually impressed without any crowd control. They've been able to do it so well in the top lane.
Yeah, I mean, Gnar's maneuverability is limited when you don't have the hop, and even if you do, if you don't see a dive coming, there's not much you can do to get away from it, so it seems like Soul could be playing a little bit safer. Doesn't really have too many wards to protect him. Well, he does now, but I don't know if he did before. If those wards were there before, then and he got dived, then he deserved to die, I think. Yeah, you need to be aware of who's going to be in your jungle if you're a top laner in that situation.
But it doesn't really matter how far behind the Gnar gets. It's mostly just about keeping the Kog'Maw and the Lulu in an acceptable situation.
Yeah. I mean, Gnar just needs to hit people with his ult.
Yes.
And he can have any number of items to do that.
And you have no need to engage, right, with Juggernaut. You can just sit there and siege turrets. So as long as Gnar stays alive just to scoop people backwards, it's actually not the worst thing in the world. The worst thing,
they're going to go in Peanut. Secret. Takes a lot of damage. Peanut is right behind Ketch. A nice flash from OQ. A kill already for Peanut. He just threw a spear in there. Sasan teleported down, but there's really no other follow-up. Meanwhile, up in the top lane, that turret nearly dead.
Yeah.
And when it does die, Soul may follow soon afterwards because Duke has the Phage now, too.
Yeah, there's the giant spell coming in from Soul. Maybe he wanted to go for a Frozen Mallet, but he's so far behind, he just can't build that anymore. He's going to have to build Randuin's Omen. And, Duke.
I don't know if you want to attack the turret there, Duke.
He just wants to. Oh, he's going to go for it right as the turret dies.
Damage,
there
man.
We go.
Burns the ignite. The turret goes down, and so does Soul.
Soul dying to the ignite. Great play from Duke.
Yeah. That's
judging the turret death on the minion damage.
A good case of knowing your limits right there. Whoa, secret. There's no limit to the amount of times that Najin can kill him in a situation like that. Well,
Peanut is going nuts this game.
Yeah, no
3
kidding.
3-0-3 so far.
What a statement.
Very mechanical player, very aggressive player.
Yep.
Give him a champion like Nidalee and he can carry you. That's for sure.
That's looking pretty good.
Yeah, the downside to Peanut, which you're not seeing here, is if he plays against a very good jungler and you are actually there to answer some of these dives and shut him down, he can overextend it and die. So
yeah,
you have to be very careful about that.
He does suffer against good counter jungling. But Catch has been having a hard time with regular jungling, so counter jungling is definitely right out for him.
Well, Catch has been identifying the lanes he needs to help. He's not trying to help his Gnar anymore. That is going to be a fruitless endeavor.
Yeah.
But there's a huge gold lead now, but you can't really fault Catch because the most important champions have been doing okay. We look at the Kog'Maw, slightly up in CS, but that is who you need to get rolling because the late game is still very potent from Spenu. unlikely that they're ever going to get there, particularly because this Hecarim is so huge that a teleport engage will absolutely ruin the Kog'Maw.
Yeah, it's going to be tough to keep Nuclear alive, that's for sure. And meanwhile, you know, while all this is going on, OQ and Tank are steadily gaining in strength so that when they actually get involved in some of these team fights, they're going to start to do a ton of damage themselves, too.
Yeah, that is a major concern. Fortunately, OQ not too fed this game.
But as we've seen before, it only takes OQ one fight and then he just gets a quadra kill.
Oh.
I've seen this one before. This is one where Soul dies, right? Yep, it was. Duke and Peanut with another dive.
Peanut's accuracy. Oh, poor Soul. There's something you can do against that at this point. You're trying to fight against a completed Trinity Force.
Yeah. Yep. He's in jail this game. And here we go. Trying to go into Pure. And that's a four-man dive in the bot lane. Pure gets hit by Pulverize, but OQ in a lot of trouble. He'll get taken out by Catch. Meanwhile, Duke comes down. What can they do with this? Where's the mid laner here? Peanut joining the fray soon. Spear doesn't hit anyone. But here he comes. Duke, there's a kill for Nuclear, and Peanut overextending, jumps into that 1v4, and Tank, he's going to try to clean this up. Man, that was the problem.
Like
a pentakill situation
that,
for Tank.
That was the problem with Peanut right there.
Yep.
You definitely do not jump into four members while Wild Growth is still up.
Yeah.
That he was not counting on that ability. You can't try and make a play right there. A nice dive from Spenu, but really a poor response from Najin in that regard. Once Spenu had the right idea. They see the play being made top lane again, so let's go dive OQ. Try and shut him down, get our Kog'Maw ahead. Well, it works, but a lot of that was filtering in one by one. Duke got the initial damage down, but had Peanut just waited for Victor, basically Duke had them boxed in.
Yeah.
They had a turret on the other side. They could have just poked them down with lasers and spears and then finished it off. But Peanut had to try to be the hero, and therefore they couldn't actually collect any kills or punish Spenu for that overextension.
OQ doing some damage to Secret, and Nuclear's right there. Pops the culling, but Secret so tanky against this. OQ, no! Oh, they're going to try to dive it, but the dive is already happening onto OQ. Explosive cast knocks him against the wall. Spear. It's like his own team was trying to kill him so he wouldn't have to die to the enemy. Yeah. Well,
yeah,
they get the mid lane turret for it, but this game's gotten a little bit silly at this point.
There's no denial mechanic in this game, Noah.
Nope. Oh, well.
I'm pretty sure that sometimes Najin wishes there was.
Yeah, I think so.
OQ.
OQ jumps in like that. Yeah, that was definitely an OQ moment.
What is he building? He bought a recurve bow and then sold it.
I don't know. Wit's End.
Oh,
we found him. Throws up the shield right away. Secret not taking a whole lot of damage. There's Tank as well. Everybody kind of hanging out in a choke. Pure pops his ultimate, and he's still in a lot of trouble. Gravity Field brings in Catch, and it looks like Pure will be tanky enough to get out. Whoa, here comes Nuclear. Maybe I spoke too soon. Sasan doing the damage, and Nuclear picks up a kill. Yep, this game is officially silly at this point.
Well, this is what we were talking about. Pure and Peanut getting too big for their britches and trying to make plays against a Braum. And remember, Pure went in with headbutt pulled against that Braum. All Secret had to do was pop Unbreakable, stand there and laugh at a diddly spear, and the rest of his team was there to get the kill.
Yes. And in his hubris, Peanut met his end.
I mean, I want Peanut to develop into a good player because I really think he's a fun player to watch. He's like Tom, very aggressive, very mechanical, but he needs to think sometimes. He's like how OQ used to be, though. OQ
it's
developed
true.
Into a good player.
That's true. You just need to start thinking, and it helps you become a good player. It's great advice.
Use your brain.
Yeah.
Don't bait Pure into crazy initiations like that. Oh, I got
it's
this
like,
Braum.
Dude, initiate. I'll be right behind you. Now you're dead. Nice KDA.
And dead he was.
Yeah. Well, still a decent game overall for Peanut. But they do need to be legitimately careful. They gave a couple kills to the Kog'Maw.
Yes.
Sasan's got a good amount of assists. You can't do that too many more times. Najin. Otherwise, this game will become a lot closer and a lot harder to win.
Yes, do not go into the late game only 5K ahead or 4K ahead up against a Juggernaut composition. You should be quite afraid of that occurring.
Well, the nice thing is that Spenu has absolutely no chance of challenging this dragon, so Najin will take another comfort one there. And they do have all the other outer turrets done, so at least they've got that. Second dragon, taken by Najin.
Right away. Now, what are they going to do with this? Are they actually going to start threatening a Baron early? Interestingly, OQ finishing his static shiv before his Infinity Edge. That's something that we rarely see.
It's a very low damage Lucian then, too.
Yeah, it has some decent wave clear, though. He's just not going to be critting yet, so he's not really useful in teamfights, but he is quite useful for clearing out minion waves and applying pressure, which will keep Najin next to their towers and open up the map for the rest of his team. And I actually like this choice because Peanut is really fed. Yeah. So if Peanut can safely walk around the enemy jungle and try and make picks, that could be in your advantage.
Well, Peanut got a pretty fast Rod of Ages too, so he is legitimately powerful both in terms of health and damage he can put out.
Yeah, and the more wards that go in, the more you keep the waves up, the faster Peanut can just chew through the enemy jungle. You can control that blue buff, and you will be feeling good. So Najin just playing a full press here across all the lanes, even if OQ not going to be the best at actually trading or having much kill threat, he can at least out-push the Kog'Maw.
Yeah, Duke's still doing fine as well, too. Gonna try to take this Raptor. Peanut gets it. Got the Raptor. There goes the turret. And Soul on the run again. 050, 40 CS down. It's a
three
tough
levels
day.
Down.
Oh, wow, you're right.
That is enormous. This is what Duke can do to you.
Yeah, we've seen Duke do this kind of thing to a few different top laners.
So, making a switch right now, Lucian should be moving into the top. Oh, no, just going back to buy. No Lucian in the top lane quite yet. Duke obviously has much more ability to kill the towers right now. Goes back. He's just picking up resists across the board. Glacial Shroud. Now he's got a Cowl with those home guards. Feeling very good about fighting anyone in this situation before he finishes off his Frozen Heart.
Last summer, or last season, it was the Suffering of the Lilac. And this summer, or this season, this summer. This season, it's the Suffering of the Soul.
Yes, that's a deep dollar, the Suffering of the Soul.
I'm pretty sure that was like a Hallmark movie or TV at some point, but it also describes the position of this Gnar in this game.
Yeah, this is pretty... They really ganged up on him in the top lane, and once he started falling behind like that, there really wasn't much more to be done.
Yeah. He's kind of left alone in top lane island, which was then repeatedly invaded.
You don't want to be left alone with Duke at top lane island. That is that is not a fun place to be when there is a Trinity Force Centaur rampaging through the wilds.
Even especially if it's like a weird like robo centaur too.
Is that worse than a normal centaur?
I don't know. I don't know enough centaurs to really say so.
Well, you know that in ancient Greek literature, centaurs were known for their sexual desires, right? So
I didn't know that.
So I would somewhat feel more comfortable around a robo-centaur because that would be less of a concern.
You don't think they were programmed to...
No.
Okay.
Nope.
No, you don't. All right. I mean, I'm just saying, some robots, that's all. I don't know.
That is centaur mythology, though.
Okay.
Quite carnal creatures, if you will.
That happens sometimes, you know?
Centaurs happen.
Centaurs happen. Quick, somebody make that t-shirt. Here comes a centaur, it's about to happen to Spenu. Or not. Oh, come on. That would have been perfect, Duke. What are you doing to me? I'll never look at centaurs the same again.
See, that's why you should know about the original stories behind some of these mythological creatures.
Sure puts a lot of that first Harry Potter book in a different light, doesn't it?
Sure does. Yeah.
Oh, wow.
Also, what happens to Umbridge in Harry Potter? Just going to put that on the tape.
Wow. That's okay. Okay. Yeah, well, you know, whatever floats your boat, I guess, or whatever gallops your centaur.
That's why it's fun to know about mythology, everybody.
Sure is.
Because then you understand the context of things like this, and certain things get seen in a very different light.
Yeah, there's a lot of stuff going on with animals back then, the stories.
That's also why, one of the many reasons why Harry Potter is terrible, because it just mashes together all of these different myths without regard to where they came from or what they actually mean. Congratulations, you've ripped off every culture on the planet without actually understanding the symbolism.
Oh no, Duke! The onslaught's away. More like an offslaught.
They definitely need some Baron wards down if you're not.
Yeah.
The warding is getting a little bit sloppy right now.
In general, this game is pretty sloppy at the moment. Or not the moment, pretty much sloppy for the last 20 minutes or so. Yeah, Najin definitely not taking this one as seriously as they could.
Yeah, the thing is, Spenno tried to dedicate four people into the topside for a Tier 1 turret, so they lose a Tier 2, and they're going to lose a dragon as a response. They got a ward onto the Baron, so that is not going to be an answering play from Spenno. They probably should have tried, though, honestly. They probably shouldn't have backed. They probably should have just tried to go for that Baron if they knew when the dragon timer was coming through.
Third dragon taken easily by Najin. And at this point, Najin has that speed boost from the third dragon buff. And they can ideally use it to run around and put more wards down. And Peanut, you know, so kill crazy, it's not too surprising to see the warding getting a little bit neglected this game.
Well, he's also playing Nidalee, who is going to have fewer wards. Sure,
probably not going to buy Sidestone, yeah.
Yeah, you're not going to buy the Sidestone. You instead upgrade your ward totem to help out. But in general, when you're playing in Nidalee, there will be fewer wards on the map. You just have to kind of accept that.
I suppose.
You're actively purchasing them.
I'm just waiting for the Raptors. Are not going to come back because you just killed him. Well, Najin trying to get some more vision into the enemy jungle here.
Duke actually recalling
for
his spirit visage.
And I would have thought they'd be putting a little bit more pressure onto Baron right now.
Yeah, they have to clear that out. You do really just want to try and take that or force it. OQ is there in a brush. He's going to actually get a ton of damage on a catch.
There's the culling, and he's got a lot of damage. That is how you execute a good culling, ladies and gentlemen.
OQ is so good at hitting the culling, and that's going to prompt the Baron.
Yeah, I mean, the thing is Duke can teleport back in if he needed to, and he doesn't because he's down in the bot lane, and nobody's going to stop his team from doing this. Or are they? Yep. Nobody is. And flash over the wall, headbutt pulverized. Secret goes in by himself. Here's the teleport. Duke comes in. He's all over Sasa Nuclear. Big, big play there with the Onslaught of Shadows. The Chaos Storm chasing down the support. Another kill comes in for Tank.
Wow, just nothing you could do right there. Great engage over the wall on the Alistar. And then the Onslaught of Shadows, perfect to push Sasa and Nuclear back towards his team, setting up that big Chaos Storm.
Yeah. And now, with the Baron buff, this could be a pretty easy inhibitor. They're going to go on to Soul. Soul taking a lot of damage. Peanut getting very aggressive there. Whoa, explosive cast. Not used at the best time for catch, and that's going to cost them an inhibitor now.
Yes, it will. One inhib down. How far do they want to push it? Duke already split pushing and bringing that minion wave to the tower on the top side.
This Baron is going to wreck Spenu right now.
They will back off.
I guess so.
Not a lot of mana left on anyone, really, on Najin. So use the money you just earned. You have that naked and hip. Should be simple to take it as you come back through. Sasan has that Medge Eyes. Just not going to be doing that much work for him. Tank, actually, interesting build. Rylai's. and then a Negatron cloak. So Rylai's Abyssal.
I mean, if you get Rylai's, you can slow people down, obviously, with your Death Ray. Everything slows. You can help players like OQ and Duke catch up and stay within melee range, make it easier for Spears hit from Peanuts. So I could see reasons behind it. It also does make you tanky, too, which makes you more resilient versus the poke from Kog'Maw as well.
It definitely does that. Obviously, Rylai's is a good item. Whether it's a good item on Victor, I don't know if I necessarily agree with that.
I don't know if it really matters this game, though. OQ with the culling. He just culls Saucin.
Saucin
right
didn't
off
even
the map.
Ult himself right there. Had an opportunity to use Wild Growth, but decides not to. I guess he just wants to get culled.
With a 40-second death timer, I think I would have ulted there.
OQ's cullings are so good.
Yeah, they are. That was actually OQ's first kill of the game, by the way. Weirdly enough. Well, two inhibitors down now. They're going to rotate to bottom lane. The minion wave is already there.
They've done such a huge amount of work with this Baron buff. Just very clean snowballing from Notch in this game after getting the Baron.
Nice spear on the nuclear. They could theoretically get all three inhibitors with one Baron, and I think they will. Yes, they will. So before the Baron runs out, all three inhibitors taken by Najin. Doesn't get much more one-sided than this, and it looks like they're ready to just try to end here.
Well, why not? You have so many minions just pouring into the base.
Oh, Saucin takes a lot of damage. There goes the Chaos Storm again.
Oh, wow.
Getting low as well, too. They're going to try to go in. Soul in the back line's a big Gnar ultimate. But can they follow it up? Najin fairly low health across the board, but there goes one Nexus turret, and Najin is indeed ready to end this game. Soul low, and there's the Onslaught of Shadows as Duke comes in. OQ wants another kill before the game is over, and the Nexus getting poked away now, and it looks like that's going to be it. So a 2-0 for Najin. There we go. OQ, I knew he was going to get a couple kills in there at the end. GG.
The stylish kill with the flash, and that was a great Gnar ult, actually, by Soul. And had Najin not been so damn far ahead, it could have made a difference. Peanut and Tank will help their team secure a postseason berth tonight.
Yep.
That means Jhenair is not going to the playoffs, and Najin, they can still fight for seeding. They have a tough match to end the season against SK Telecom. Spenu, rough season, rough second game. They have such a good lead in the first one.
Yeah, they have one more match, I believe. But that one we just saw is one they're going to want to forget, too. And a win for Najin Empire, of course, winning it with their substitute jungler and mid laner in that second.